My name is Samir Bhagwat, and I'm Director of Quality Assurance and Engineering Services at Intrepid Control Systems. I'm going to have a brief talk on virtual ECU testing and validation. So these are the things I want to talk about, or this is the agenda. I'm going to talk about what traditionally how ECU development happens, what is causing some disruptions, and what are the disruptors for that, what is enabling virtualized ECUs, what is a virtual ECU in concept, and then to test a virtualized ECU, what kind of ecosystem is needed, and what Intrepid products are suitable for those kind of testings. So many of us here have been ECU software engineers and developers for years. And a typical recycle, you know, traditionally starting with, you know, design, development, testing, validation, and so on and so forth, is very familiar to many of us, including me. All of these require some kind of target hardware from the very beginning, because that's how we are used to. We are used to writing C code, C++, compile, build, downloading the hardware, use an in-circuit emulator or a JTAG debugger, and test the software development. So that's how you develop the ECU software for many years. Most of the higher layers in this ECUs, for example, algorithms or the things which, you know, physics needs to be tested, maybe an airbag modules deployment algorithm, those you could still test entirely in simulation without hardware, which is very normal. It has been done that way many, many years. Those layers testing never required hardware. You know, you test physics based, you know, in simulation, and it is pretty much, you know, good to go. They seem to be limitations now, because you need a setup of hardware for each engineer working on the ECU code and development. Once you develop the software, the firmware, you have ECU, and then it goes in production. And for years, there is no intention to change the software. There is no intention that we will upgrade the ECU, unless there is a bug and a recall and things like that. But otherwise, we don't upgrade ECUs in our traditional world. But that's changing for this many reasons. One is the fundamental focus of vehicle design now is software. You know, everything is around software. The approach to vehicle design starts with software first, because of, you know, electrification is the main reason. And the other prominent reason is being, there is no limitation now that you have ECU software in the, an ECU with a software in the production vehicle, and it doesn't see an update ever. That's not true anymore. You could upgrade the ECU, you could upgrade the vehicle with a new feature through OTA. And all of these is reasoned around Ethernet. With Ethernet, there is an ability, inherent ability to flash over OTA, multiple ECUs and, you know, larger machines inside the vehicle, higher end compute machines which are running algorithms, you could update them. And a lot of these upgrades are happening because OEMs are learning what the vehicle needs, you know, because of, you know, ADAS systems or because of autonomy and things like that. And to update this, it is something, a reiterative process. You learn, the algorithm learns more, you need to deploy it in the high-end machines inside the car. And all of that requires to be tested first from various perspectives, not just from the ADAS or autonomy perspective, but from network data exchange perspective too. And all of these can be driven from cloud. So all of these are really the disruptors which, you know, have questioned if the traditional ECU software development mechanisms and methods are still, you know, pertinent. Maybe for deeply embedded ECUs, it is still valid when there is, you know, limited sensing and actuation, and does not really need to upgrade. At that level, probably it is still valid. But in general, now these are the disruptors which are requiring to enhance the way we develop and test the software at a very large scale. So the key for this, and, you know, the direction is a, you know, virtualization of the hardware, essentially, for the ECU. So what is a virtual ECU? Basically, the idea is you still compile, build the firmware for that target machine or the architecture, but test it either on cloud or on the host. So essentially, you have hardware vendors providing API or providing access to semiconductor or peripheral model and libraries, and everything is virtualized right from the hardware layer up to the top. Now, when I say that, that's not like there are multiple levels of how a ECU or what level of virtual ECU is possible. I will look into that in a couple of next slides. So what does this do? Essentially, it allows to test in very early stage in an entire stack without a physical ECU. So I can have really, if my algorithm is there, if my strategy for the ECU is there, I can have a pool of engineers start testing and start developing and start making changes to improve without even the target hardware being ready. This is the direction many OEMs are going. And there is a whole ecosystem already fully functioning around this. The second thing is to do an agile regression test. If I decide to change an algorithm or a ECU, a part of ECU or a driver change, you don't need to completely build, you know, design, develop, and have hardware, and then hardware ship to different teams to do their changes and their testing. This all can be done in virtualized environment, and all you do is deploy the new binary in the cloud or whatever way you want to, and all the engineers can start running their tests. So it's a very quick iteration compared to trying to provide hardware access to each and every team which needs to test or change, make the change. The other thing is the highest test coverage, as you know, once you have an ECU which is completely virtualized, the possibility of being able to test every path very early and in the widest possible sense, because you have a larger pool of engineers, you have access to that stack of ECU software virtually from anywhere, you know, because it's in cloud. You could run your regression test in the cloud itself by access to the system. So virtual ECU, that's the idea behind it. And as I said, there are multiple levels. You know, being able to test an algorithm or application layer in software has always been done. I have done myself years and years of algorithm testing without any hardware. That has always been there. So that is a kind of virtual ECU. So at that level, you could still compile your higher layers in the host PC environment and test it. And most possibly, there is no dependence on the target, you know, architecture of the hardware, you know, what MCU you are running or what SoC you are running. And that will still be good to go. So at a lowest level of virtualization, your application level software is tested without a real ECU. You build the upper layers, compile, build, you know, and hope, you know, test on the host environment, maybe x86 or a, you know, PC based environment. That's fine. That's where you build the upper layers. You still need to have some kind of code to interface it with the host environment, and which has really no impact on the test itself. And that's really not 100% production code, you know, at that level of, you know, virtualization, it's not a production code, it's not 100% production code. But you do test all the hardware independent layers. You could do that, and you know that at that level, you do not need the target hardware. At the highest level of virtualization, you have the physical, the CPU simulation, the device driver simulation, and complete Intel layer from, for example, AutoSAR is virtualized. This means you are actually building the binary for the target for which your end hardware target. You're building the binary and you're testing that binary on the host. So that is like your highest level of ECU virtualization. And in this case, you have, you know, OS and, you know, POSIX-based OS, or you have bare metal, whatever, in the entire stack with completely production intent binary, and you test it in either cloud or on your host. Like as if you were bit testing on the actual ECU hardware. So, and these are not just the two levels. If you look into the suppliers for the virtual ECU, there are various different intermediate levels in between in this lowest to highest level of virtualization. And depending on to what extent the testing is done and to what extent the testing is done at what level, at what layer. Essentially these are the two ends of the virtualized ECU. Alrighty, where do we come into picture? So we don't make virtual ECU. We don't make the model for virtual ECU, but we are a main player when it comes to network level testing for virtualized ECU. For all the rest bus simulation, you still need the rest bus simulation. All the networks for CAN, LIN, whatever the Ethernet, and the support towards the database, we do provide that. We have diagnostic support specifically for virtualized ECU testing. We allow for measurement signal, for PDU measurements, function block scripting, and all other scripting are still valid in the virtual environment too. And this all comes from our traditional vehicle spy software you've seen, in demos here. The next level of support we have in virtual ECU is from vehicle spy X software. And that one has our own AutoSAR COM stack and also support for service-oriented architectures, which we'll talk later in one of the presentations today. And the entire vSpy X architecture is meant to be run in your CI/CD environment with Python as the front-end interface. So we have full support for testing a virtual stack in either in the host environment, running on the host, or in the cloud environment. So this is the framework we have currently, and we work with many OEMs on this. So here, just to describe, this specifically is the virtual ECU model. This is not something we provide. So there are suppliers for this. For example, Synopsys is one of them. We have two architectures which right now are in use to help test virtual ECUs. One is where we can exist with a co-simulation platform and interface with our vehicle spy bridge API. This is our special interface to a co-simulation platform, which actually interfaces with the API of the interface for virtual ECU. We have time and message data synchronization with the virtual ECU model, and time can be controlled either way. We could be a master of basically vehicle spy bridge API can be the master for the time, or it can be a follower for the time. So this is one environment where we interface with co-simulation platform to interface with the virtual ECU model. The second is we can directly interface with the API. We can load the virtual ECU DLL, for example, directly we can load that, or the API we can load, and we can interface with virtual ECU with time and event synchronization. This, we have two methods. One is command line interface where there is no GUI, or we call it headless version, or we can go with a GUI version too. And this is where we can interface with directly, as I said, with a direct virtual ECU model through their API. This also allows, for example, if you are existing vSpy 3 configurations and you are using virtual ECU testing environment, you could still load all that, test scripts you have, all the databases you have, which you already use in vehicle spy 3. And you could load them through our API and load them to test your virtual ECU model. This means if you already, there are many OEMs and customers who are already using vehicle spy for their testing, and they have complete test suite written in depth, they can still use the same test suite. That's the good part of this. We support CAN, Ethernet, LIN, all three. And in fact, TCP IP and that level of simulation is also possible for the virtualized ECUs. Our licensing does allow to run the entire thing in your CI/CD. This means wherever you are building your ECU stack, the entire pipeline, you can just invoke vehicle spy. And that should allow invoke vehicle spy essentially and run the test and get the results back. And that should just work with our licensing. We allow XLM licensing or server-based licensing. So that should directly work. Okay, the virtual ECUs or co-sim platforms we directly work are Synopsys systems, ETAs, or DSpace Will, or if you have ASTC VLAB, we work with all of these and also a few third-party interfaces which interface with this system. And some of the things which you could do with our vehicles by CLI or GUI architecture, basically the bridge API, link bridge API or directly core interface, is you can have vehicle spy, which can demand time and increment the clock. We can have, you know, read and write into the ECUs at a very high rate. And we can support LIN Ethernet right now. There are diagnostic modes possible, so you can run the diagnostics on the ECU, the virtualized ECU, if you have diagnostic tests in the vSpy. And we do have the ability to expose our interfaces to a third-party system if you want to interface with, let's say, your own test architecture system, which talks to vSpy, which talks to virtual ECU. Then we will be able to support that. Sometimes customizations are needed for these custom applications. Things like ECU flashing, you can test complete ECU flashing for a virtualized ECU using vSpy today. So we have support for that too. Okay, just to conclude, I personally think virtual ECU technology is going to be a very prominent player going forward. I have already interacted with the ECUs where our customers bring a Linux box and say, this is the ECU. This is all new for me coming from a deeply embedded world, writing algorithms for airbag systems and all. To where a Linux box is placed, hey, this is the ECU. How can you run vSpy X here to test, you know, DOIC, for example. So, but this is the world where we are already in there. OEMs have adapted to this, and we can see the benefit for that. I can see personally a benefit of where thousands of engineers who are not on the site can test the software, can rewrite the software, can make the modification, push the pipeline, and you know, you have the entire test still running without any change. So now if there is a failure, you immediately know. And this is already happening. Vehicle spy would be my first rule if you ask me to use for network monitoring and testing for a virtual ECU. And then if, you know, vehicle spy X natively has support for virtual ECU stacks. And then, you know, ideally, since vehicle spy X is also natively Linux and Mac, Mac supportive, that is another option for virtual ECU testings.